Hello, in this tutorial I'm going to show you how to model a dancing baby Groot from Guardians of the Galaxy. I'm going to show you how to make it in both 3D Studios Max, also in Maya, and then finishing it up in ZBrush, ready for 3D printing. So without further ado, let's get busy. Okay, so starting in 3D Studios Max, under the Create tab, I'm just going to create a cylinder, and I'm going to grow it in the middle of the scene. Let's just raise this tall tower right here like this. And under the Modify tab, I'm going to just change the cylinder to an editable poly. I'm going to select the Vertex tab. I'm going to select all of these vertices, and I'm going to twist the cylinder like this, one by one. I'm going to twist it around, okay? And this is basically a base mesh for Baby Groot sapling's body. Okay, that's not a bad start. We'll take the top, which would be about his neck, and I'm just going to shrink it in, and that would sit underneath his head quite nicely, I think. And I'd say this column here would be kind of his chest, so I'm going to inflate that a little bit. In fact, I'm going to tilt it and push it out a little bit, as if this area here is kind of his chest. I'm going to take the bottom row, and I'm going to enlarge that. It's kind of the base. And I'm probably going to make this one here a little thinner. Yeah, okay. I think that's pretty spot on. Just going to make it a little taller. Okay. Now I'm going to select the edges, and holding Control, I'm going to double click each and every fourth edge loop. So that one, and that one. And the last one here. Okay, so with all of those selected, I'm going to press the Create Shape from Selection button that's just here. And that's basically going to turn all of those edges into splines. So let's click it. And we want it to be a smooth spline. So, okay. And there they are. So I'm just going to delete the existing cylinder. I'm just going to come off of Edge Mode. And press delete on the keyboard. It's leaving us with our splines. I'm just going to select these splines, and this tab will turn on. Under render, I'm going to say enable the render in the viewport. Enable render, and it draws the splines in polygons, but right now they're a little bit thin. Let's press Z for zooming in. So on these dials here, I'm just going to increase the thickness by quite a considerable amount. There we go. About like that, I think. Just zoom out a tiny bit. All right, it's not too bad. Not a bad start. Just going to increase the amount of sides a little bit as well. And that's a reasonable start, I think. Okay. So I'm going to do the exact same process again, but for the arms. So I'm going to create another cylinder. I'm just going to grow it over here, a little thinner, quite nice and tall again. I'm just going to click on this angle snap toggle here and the rotate. I'm just going to turn it on its side about 90 degrees. There we go. Move it up. Move it across. And I'd want it about here. This would be one of baby sapling Groot's arms. Do the process exactly the same again. Click on the Modify tab, change the cylinder into an editable poly, select Vertex, and begin to twist it around again. Okay, it goes around and around. I hear a song here somewhere. Okay. Now, I want this arm to have a little bit more character to it, so I'm just going to turn off the vertex mode and drop down the modifier stack. I'm going to open up an FFD, 4x4x4. I'm just going to drop that down, open its control points. I'm just going to move this out a little bit, rotate some of the points. There we go. Rotate that. It's giving this arm a little bit of character, a little bit of a bend in there. Okay, that is absolutely fine. I'm just going to collapse this stack. Let's move him in a little bit. I'm going to duplicate him by holding the shift button and dragging him out. This creates another copy. There it is. I'm just going to say OK. And I'm going to mirror it. Okay, let's mirror it by, I think, YZ, yeah. Okay, so we've got these two arms now. As before, I'm going to select every fourth edge loop. So select edge. I'm going to hold control and double click on the edge. So select this one. And that one. Tell you what, back up. There's that one. That one. And this one. There we go. And as before, I'm going to press the create shape from selection and choose smooth again. And because we turned on the render tabs on the body last time, it's instantaneously drawn it on this occasion. But they're a little bit thick, quite large. So I'm just going to come off of edge. Underneath these drawn splines is still the original arm. That's still inside there. So you can just see it peeking through here, this pink polygon. I'm just going to come off of edge mode and I'm going to delete it. It's going to disappear. And I'm going to select these guys and I'm just going to make them thinner by moving the thickness tab dial down. Okay, about that. Alright, not bad. A little bit more, just a little bit more. Okay, I'm fairly happy with that. Now we're still in editable spline mode and I want these to be turned into a polygon mode, so just right click in here, turn to editable poly. Okay, and we'll save ourselves a couple of moves by once again duplicating this, mirroring it, and replacing this guy. So actually I'll delete you, get rid of him, select all of these guys, holding shift and dragging to the left will create another copy. So yep. I want another copy, and we mirror again. And we mirrored in the same mirror direction that we last did, so we've got now got that arm twirling upwards, and that's quite nice. And we just bring him back in. Okay. So we've got a group body and the start of two arms, and we just go back to the Create tab. Under the standard primitive shapes, we're just going to create a very simple sphere. Just going to draw it down here, very small. Of course, that's Groot's head. And you can stick it on top. I'm just going to scale it up a little bit more. Only a little bit more. There we go. Let's bring it forward. Oh, it seemed to have scaled in one direction there, so let's just pull that out again. Okay. Not bad. Alright. So we've got our base group mesh. Okay, with that done, we're going to select all of these items and we're going to export them all as an OBJ. An OBJ file is a universal format which you can open up in other programs like ZBrush, which is what we're going to do. So you just click on this Max tab in the top left-hand corner and go to Export, Export selected. Just drop down this menu here and you'll find the OBJ exporter. And I'm just going to save that to my desktop as Groot. Save that out. Just export. With all that done, press the tab. Okay, so we're going to create Groot in Maya. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to create a cylinder from the Primitives tab over here. And that's going to generate into the center of the canvas. I'm just going to press F to zoom in on it. And over on the Inputs tab, I'm going to give it 21 sides. I'm going to turn off all the caps. And the reason why I'm turning off the caps is because later we're going to select edge loops and they tend to run up the top into the center and that can cause a few problems. Back on the inputs, I'm going to give it a height of 5. Okay. I'm just going to select scale from the tools on the left here. And we're just going to pull it up. Quite nice, tall and thin. I'm just going to bring up that cylinder so it sits onto the grid right here. Okay. Alright, to select the Components tab, you just hold right click on your object. I'm going to select Vertex. I'm going to begin by selecting most of the edge loops here. and rotating it from the Tools tab over here. So I'm going to move it on this axis, start twisting the geometry. Just select these. Just gradually work our way up this tower, twisting it all the way around. Okay, that's pretty cool. Alright, now I want to scale some of these edge loops so that you get a bit of form. So scale from the Tools tab. I'm going to bring that bottom one out. I'm going to squeeze in the top one, which would be his neck. The one just below that would be his chest. I'm going to bring that out. In fact, I'm going to scale it in two directions. Push it out a little bit. And just push out the waist a tad. Okay, that's pretty cool. Okay, I'm going to bring up the Component tab again by holding a right click on the object. And this time I'm going to select Edge. And if you want to select the edge loop, you just double click. You can see it goes all the way around. Okay, I'm going to convert this edge to a curve. And the way that we do that in Maya is under Modify, under Convert, Polygon Edge to Curve. But let's go into the Options, which is inside this little box on the right of it. And you just want to double check that you're on Free Cubic, which is a nice smooth curve. I'm just going to press Apply, and it automatically generates it. So I'm just going to right click again on my object, back into Edge Mode. I'm going to select every fourth edge. So select that one. Now if you press G, it should repeat your last operation. So there we go, another spline. Hold right click, edge, select another edge curve, loop, excuse me, press G, good. And gradually work our way around this cylinder. Almost done. I think that's the last one. Bop. Maybe one more in there? Yeah, okay, that's cool. Alright, now, select the cylinder, just press Control H and hide it. Now, the next thing that we're going to do is we're going to turn these splines into geometry. But just before we do that, I just want to warn you, if you right-click to the Component tab, go to Control Vertex, you'll see that your spline only has a couple of points. And this can cause a few problems when you want to create geometry along it. You end up with some low resolution results, and we don't want that. So I'm just going to go back to object mode. And we're going to rebuild these curves. And the way you do that is just select them all. Under the menu set, choose Surfaces, Edit Curves. I'm going to rebuild the curve. And inside the options, once again, we want to make sure we've got Free Cubic, which is a very smooth curve. I'm going to give it, I'm going to bump it up to about 10. Okay, press apply. Now you won't see much of a change, but once again, if you right click, go to Control Vertex, you'll see that we've now got more points in there. Okay, pretty cool. So it's time to place some geometry onto these. So let's select them all. Once again, under the menu set, I'm going to change it to the rendering. Inside Rendering, under Paint Effects, Curve Utilities, we've got Attach Brush to Curves. And the minute we press that, it should auto-generate. Now, I'm not sure why, but in Maya, when you attach a brush utility, it comes out black, and the visibility is a little low. So if anyone knows how to change that, do let me know. But what we're going to do is, we're going to increase the width of them because they're a little thin right now. So I'm just going to select them all, and you can do this en masse. And on the channel box, just scroll down below the shape, and in the inputs you'll see brush. Not too far down in what appears to be a rather overwhelming amount of values, you'll see brush width. I'm going to change that to about 20, 0.20. Let's just type that in again. That's pretty cool. Okay, now we're almost there, but I'd say that these cylinders, these splines, are lacking some tube sections. So we're just going to increase that. I'm going to select one at a time. I don't think you can do this operation en masse. So with that selected, press Control A. It's going to bring up more options. And once again, under the Brush tab, under mesh, there's tube sections. I'm going to give them about 20 each. You'll see that bumps up. I'm going to zoom in a bit, select each one of these. 20. 20. That's cool. 20. Nearly done. Brush. 20. I think we've got one more in there. There we go. Little brush tab. 20. And that's pretty... Oh, one left in there. Once again, as I was saying, being black, it's not very visible. 20. That's cool. So there's one last thing to do, and that is to modify these, to convert them into polygons, because they're not quite editable geometry just yet. So under the set menu, no, under modify, excuse me, I'm going to convert, and we're going to change under convert paint effects to geometry, which is right here, excuse me, paint effects to polygons even, and we just press this, and you don't see a lot change, but what it's done is it's auto-generated a new copy underneath the original. So if we just pull them out, this should be the new ones. I'm just going to put a Lambert material on there, so assign a new material, a Lambert. Okay, I'm going to delete the originals, just move this guy back into the center. There we go. That's a pretty good start. Pretty good. I'm just going to close this. Alright, so all we have to do is repeat this process for Groot's arms. So once again, I'm going to create a cylinder, which is going to generate in the center of the canvas. I'm just going to move it up here. I'm going to rotate it 90 degrees, I think, on the x-axis. Yeah, minus 90 degrees. Or 90 degrees, I don't think that makes any difference. And under the inputs, I'm going to bring this down to about 10. And there's two ways you can do that. You can either type that in, like that, or you can actually select the subdivision axis by name, and using the middle mouse button, you can scroll left and right in the canvas to go through that. So we'll leave it at 10. And give it a height, again, of 5. And turn off the caps. I'm just going to scale this out in the y-axis and scale it in, make it nice, nice slim arm. And we're going to begin to do the rotation like we did earlier. So right-click to select the component tab, choose vertex, select most of these verts, and rotate, and rotate. Keep going around till we get to the end. Nearly there. Cool. That's pretty good. And we're just going to put a wave in this arm. So it's not just a stick man arm. This is looking a bit like a scarecrow. I want to put a bit of life into this. So we can do that very quickly just by moving the verts again. Right click, hold, verts. I'm going to lift this up. Push this up. I'm going to rotate it a little bit. Oh, no, I don't want to autosave just now. Rotate. Push it up. And rotate this one a bit. And push that up as well. You don't have to do exactly the same as what I'm doing. You can play around a bit and do something that you know makes you happy. Well, that should be pretty good. So time to select the edge loop. So hold right click. Edge. Double click on the edge to select it, and under modify, go to convert, and poly edge to curve. Once again, check sure the options are on free cubic, say apply, and close this box. Go to edge mode again, I think every third edge will do. Tap G to repeat your last, and work our way around this cylinder. Already on the last one, I think. No, one more after that. Cool. Select the cylinder inside. Just press Control H to hide it. We're going to rebuild these curves again, just as we did before. So under the menu set, go to Surfaces, Edit Curves, rebuild the curve. We're already on 3 cubic. I think 5 will do this time, half of what we had earlier. Apply, double check, pretty good. Select all your splines under rendering, paint effects, curve utilities, attach brush to curve, select all of those guys again, scroll down here to the brush input, not too far down, you've got the brush width, and I think we'll do 10, that's pretty cool. Okay, just want to up the tube sections again, so select one, control A, and under the brush tab, under mesh tube sections, I think 10 should be enough. So 10 on this guy, 10 on that guy. Let's just gradually work our way around these. And that's all of them. Select them all. Now we're going to convert them to polygons. So convert, paint effects to polygons, zoom out a little bit, the pivots at the bottom there, just going to pull those guys back, going to delete the originals, select those guys, the new ones, right click, and we're going to add a Lambert texture again, just push them back. Okay, we've got an arm. Now then, just to make things nice and simple, to make the other arm, we're not going to have to go through this process again. With all of those guys selected, I'm just going to collapse them to a single object by going to, under the set menu, back to polygons, and under mesh, we're just combine them, so it's nice, one object now. And I'm just going to duplicate it by pressing Control D. I'm going to mirror it by minusing the scale, basically. So we're just going to negative that scale to -1. That should flip it over. You can also do it in the y-axis as well. Whoop, that's flipped it down there, but that's not a problem. We'll just move it up. That's pretty cool. You have to be careful though when you mirror objects this way in Maya, because you can get inverse mesh normals. And there's one way that we can, a couple of things we can do to check that and make sure that we don't get that, and it's under Control A, under the render stats, you can see that double-sided is being presently drawn right now, and this particular option makes it difficult to tell if you've got flip normal. So if we turn it off, it's actually looking pretty good, but let's just go under Modify, and we're just, what I want to do is I want to remove those negative scales, okay? So under the Modify, we're just going to freeze transformations. I think we're pretty good. Let's just make sure everything's looking right. I'm just going to turn this body into one object as well. Mesh, combine. Make sure, yep, all the normals are looking good. All right, we're nearly there. Just going to create a sphere and scale that up. And of course, this is going to be Groot's head. Up on top of his shoulders, a little bit bigger. Just make it a little oval. Bring it here. Nope, I do not want to autosave. Just bring that up. Pop it right on top. Now that looks to me like a pretty good start. Okay. Alright, so we're over in ZBrush now. And I'm just going to import our base mesh that we made earlier. So I'm just going to click on the load button here. And I tell you what, I'm not going to click on the load button. I'm going to click on the import button. And I'm going to bring it in from the desktop. There we are. Okay, so we have nothing. Okay, well, what is going on here? So if you open up the subtool tab here, you'll see that our base mesh has successfully been loaded in. And what we need to do is we need to draw it onto the canvas. And the way that we do that is we hold left click and we just drag down, and there you go, he emanates into the center of the canvas. So let's begin to sculpt. Hang on. Holy, what's going on? Okay, so we can't actually sculpt on our base mesh just yet, and that's because we're still in the 2D element of ZBrush. You see, ZBrush is a 2D and a 3D hybrid art package. So The first thing that we need to do when we drag in our geometry is we need to click on the edit button. So I'm just going to press Control N and clear the canvas. I'm going to drag it out with the left mouse button again, and then I'm going to press the edit button. Now you'll see that this frame emerged around our scene, and if I hold left and start to rotate inside the viewport, we successfully have something that we can work on here. I'm going to press move here just to navigate my character into the center of the screen. Alright, so there's a couple of things I want to do when I start a scene. It's just to make everything very clear for me. So one of those things is I'm not a big fan of this black background, so I just want to change it to a nice crisp white color. If you just look over here in the swatch, we actually have white selected. So you just click on document and press back, which means background. Boom, we get a nice white bright backdrop. That's pretty cool. So as I continue, there's something I want to do, which is I want to check on the wireframe of my geometry, and that's quite an important thing that we want to do. And to do that, you click on this polyframe button over here. But it's not very clear with this red metcap that usually arrives as a default in ZBrush. So I want to change that also to a white material. In this case, I'm going to choose the skin shade 4. I quite like that one. Okay. Alright, things are very clear now. So we can see both our wireframe and something else here, these colors. And these are known as polygroups, and we're going to talk about those shortly. And they're very, very powerful, and they help us to select our tools and move things around easier. So what's the first thing I'm going to do? So what I want to do is I want to turn each and every one of these elements, these kind of tendrils, to have its own individual polygroup. So to do that, I first just want to come down to polygroups and press auto groups. And look at that, you get this lovely display of unique colors for each and every element. So there's one more thing I need to do, and I'm going to split all of these up into individual pieces because we've only got one tool here. So to do that, we're going to click on the split tab inside the subtools, and we're going to do a group split. I'm just going to say always OK to skip until the next restart. And if you look closely, it's exploded. And that is a lot of items. And that's going to look a little bit daunting at first. You know, the idea of having to come up here and select all of these pieces, that's a bit of a drag. But there is an easier way that we can actually move things around. So if you have a small enough brush size, all you have to do is just press Alt and click on the piece that you want. And look at that, you can actually quite quickly select any item that you want, so that's pretty cool as well. Just before I get ahead of myself though, just want to add one caveat, and that is, if you happen to have made this base mesh in Maya, it's quite possible that if you look underneath at the base, it's quite possible that at the end of each one of these tendrils, you might actually have an open polygon, and you won't see this cap. And if that is the case, this is a very easy fix. All you've got to do is go to the Geometry tab, and inside of the Modify Topology, there's a Close Holes tab. If you just click that, it will automatically fill in that hole. Now, I made this in Max, and it just seems to take care of that job a little bit better, so just be warned, okay? Okay, so I want to get sculpting pretty soon, but one of the things I want to do is up the resolution on some of this geometry on Groot's base. But I got a little bit ahead of myself when I split up all of these items, and as such, I'd have to do the operation on each and every one of them. So I'm going to show you how to merge items back together again. So I'm just going to scroll down on the Subtool tab here, and I'm going to merge them downwards. Okay, so merge down. I'm going to say always skip this, and we'll start to group them back together again. Okay, so I can see that there's one more to go, and it doesn't appear to be at the bottom of the subtool tab. So where is that guy? So if I press Alt to select him, it reveals to me in the subtool palette that he's at the top here. So he seems to have gotten away from the other guys, so I'm just going to move him down the subtool palette all the way to the bottom, where I can then merge him down together again. So we've learned how to merge and split items and how to navigate around the subtool palette. All right, okay, so I just turned off the polyframe by pressing Shift and F. And if we look at our tendrils, you'll notice that they're looking a little bit low resolution and a bit faceted. So I want to begin to smooth up all of these pieces. So the way I'm going to do that is just open up the Geometry tab here, I'm going to press this divide button a couple of times. So as you know, each time I press it, the geometry looks a little bit smoother. All right, so I'm going to leave it at the fourth subdivision. And now I'm going to go back into the subtools. I'm going to split this yet again. So let's do a group split. And once again, it's exploded everything. And if we go back to the geometry tab, you'll notice that it still maintained the subdivision levels. So even if we merge and split objects, they'll always remain there. And that's pretty cool. But now I would like to turn this into a piece of dynamesh geometry. So I'm just going to press Shift F again to bring back the polyframe. And notice the topology here is those subdivision levels on it. Okay, now I'm going to set this to a resolution of 256 in the dynamesh, but just before I do that, I want to give you a warning that if you were to press this button, it will give you a warning that it doesn't like the subdivision levels being on a piece of geometry before you do a dynamesh. So we're very quickly just going to remove this from the geometry just by clicking the delete lower. Okay, so that's been taken away from there. I'm just going to work my way around each one of these and remove it from each one. That's pretty cool. There we go, very quick. I think we've got them all. Yeah, okay. So now we're ready to dynamesh. So you could type in 256. And you can see that it's been retopographized into the dynamesh geometry there. That's cool. And once again, we'll just quickly do that to each one. Okay. Yeah, last one. Cool, got them all. With that done, we're now ready to go to work on Groot's body. So the first thing I'm going to do is overview two brushes that I'm going to predominantly use. And the first one would be the Move brush, which is a very common and very powerful brush, which just allows me to move large swathes of geometry at a whim, and that's pretty cool. And the other one is the Inflation brush, which is going to help me to add volume to a lot of these areas and begin to fill in some of these gaps. So I'm going to start right here. Okay, now we're up there at Groot's chest. And as I begin to inflate, it starts to stress the geometry, and that's where we're going to use dynamesh. So we can either press this button here, or we can hold control, drag out a marquee, and it will update the geometry like that. That's pretty cool. So I just want to choose another tendril, so just click Alt and click on the object that you want. I'm going to begin to inflate some of that up. Let's just bring the size of my brush down a little bit. Start to fill in some of that area there. Okay, that's not too bad. Just press Control, drag out marquee, update the dynamesh. Loving that dynamesh. Let's get this guy as well. Start to inflate down here a little bit. Let's just go back to the Move tool. Just drag him up there a little bit like that. That's okay. We've got a bit of a very large gap there. I want to leave it a little gap though because I want the arms to kind of go in there as well. So let's just up that a little bit as well. Let's bring this in. This part of the tutorial is going to probably take a little bit of a while. So, you know, what we're trying to go for here is basically the way a root system kind of grows into a tree. So bring up some real world reference if you need to, or fantasy even, such as the beanstalk from Jack and the Beanstalk, and you'll get a good feel for the way that these tendrils kind of grow and overlap and intersect on one another. So I'm going to pause the camera and kind of get busy, and we'll come back a little later when we've got a little further ahead. So good luck and happy sculpting. So I've spent a bit of time on the body, and if we take a closer look at each and every one of these tendrils, you can see that I've kind of made them weave in and out of each other. Some of them are overlapping on one another, and there's a nice sense of geometry flow going on, not just that kind of standard helix that we had at the start. If you look at the side also, we've kind of maintained that kind of slim waistline and the chest that's kind of coming out a little bit, kind of showing some form of anatomy. Okay, just turn the polyframe on. As you can see in the subtool palette, we have all of those separate tendrils here. So I'm just going to merge them all down one last time. Let's just merge. Bring them all together. I'm just going to press Poly Groups Auto one last time just to reset all of the individual colors. Okay, that's cool. So I'm going to get ready to dynamesh down all of these components on the body, but I want to talk about this area at the bottom here. Okay, so let's just take a little look underneath and see what's going on. So there's this hole, and I want to fill it up because I don't want it to be hollow. I want the interior of this base to be solid. We are 3D printing this, and I don't want that to cause any problems. So what I can do to fill this in is, you know, kind of think of it just like clay. I'm just going to find an object that I can plug up this hole with. And a pretty good place to start would be by appending a new sphere. So in the Subtools tab, I'm just going to say Append, and I'm going to add a sphere. So it arrives in the scene a little bit on the large side. So despite it being appended, just take a look in the Subtools and you will see that you haven't actually got it selected. You've still got the last tool that you had selected. So let's select that sphere, and of course it will highlight in a lighter color to identify that it's actually selected. Or in this case, you'll see the polyframe because we do have that turned on. And I'm just going to go to the Geometry tab and change undersize, just shrink it down a little bit more. That's pretty good. It's going to bring the camera down. Let's select the transpose tool, and I'm just going to move it into place. Okay, so let's just move this guy down right about here. Let's just look directly under it. Okay, that's not too bad. Tell you what, I'm just going to bring it down a little bit more. And the reason why I don't mind that poking out is I know that after I've dynameshed this all down, I'm actually going to use a clip tool. It's just going to give it a nice slice, a nice flat surface here. So, tell you what, I'm also going to scale it just a tad. So we're in scale mode, just bring that up. Yeah, okay, that's pretty cool. So back over to the Subtool palette, I'm going to merge that to the rest of the body base. Let's merge down. All right. Pretty cool. So now I'm going to fuse all of this together with Dynamesh. Okay, what? Let's just have a look and see what's going to happen here. So I'm going to do a reasonably high resolution operation. I'll give it 1K. And let's see that work. So the operation is completed and we have a pretty good result. We just turn off polyframe. I really like this result. At 1K, the intersection points are still looking very sharp. It hasn't turned into a kind of smushed effect that you can get on lower resolutions. And if we look underneath here, that hole has been quite well plugged up, so I'm quite happy about that. So the next thing I'm going to do is I'm just going to slice this here, and we're going to use... There's quite a few slice tools. I think the one that we would like to use is actually the trim curve. Okay, so select that, say okay, and the way that we use that is we hold control and then shift, and if you notice up here the tool has now become active. I'm just going to left click and drag out control shift left click and drag out this line. Now what's going to be cut is everything above the gray gradient. So we've actually got this upside down. We actually want it this way up. Now it doesn't look like I'm touching the model now that I've just flipped that over, but if you press spacebar you can move this thing all over. So I want to cut round about here, so if I just let go we have a perfect slice. That's exactly what I want. That's pretty cool. Alright, so I'd call that done on the base of Groot's body, and what we want to do now is work on the arms. Okay, so now we're going to look at the arms, and this is going to be pretty much the same process as what we did for the body, only this time we're probably able to do it a little bit faster since we've had some experience before. So earlier on we gave all of these individual elements a polygroup color, and if you'd like to see those again you just press either the polyframe button here or on your keyboard you press Shift and F. Okay, so as before the resolution is a little bit low, so I'm just going to up the geometry a little bit. So under the Geometry tab, just going to press Divide and take it up to subdivision level 4, and as before I'm going to delete that before I do my Dynamesh operations. So let's delete that, and you can see that we've got that really dense high resolution geometry going on. Okay, well let's just zoom in a little bit. Alright, so now I'm going to split these all up. So under Subtool, you can see that we've got this one grouped tool. So we're just going to go to the Split tab, press Group Split, just skip this mark, and once again it's going to explode. So I'm just going to work my way through each of those individual pieces and give them a new Dynamesh resolution. Now earlier on the body here, we used, or we started at least, at a resolution of 250 or 256, I think. Well, I'm going to just up it a little bit more. I'd like to work with maybe 400. Also note though that this is still in 1000. It always leaves the last resolution that you worked at on each individual piece as well. And 1000 is what we used on the body. So don't forget to move this down to whatever res you want. So I'm going to try 400. All right, so I'm just going to click off the Dynamesh button and then back onto it again. You can see that topography has now changed. So I'm just going to press Alt on the next tool. And as you can see, it's at 1000 again. So each time, take it to 400. Now you don't have to press this button, remember. You can also press Control and using the left mouse button, draw out this marquee, and that will also do a Dynamesh operation. So let's go on to the next one. Drag that out. And the next one. Whoa, back up. So did you see that I left the 1000 resolution on there? That's a little bit much. So like I say, back down to 400. Let's just do the slightest little update on that so that it does read that we're going to do a Dynamesh operation on it again. Otherwise, nothing will happen. So there we go, brought it back down to 400. And then on this guy, done the exact same thing again. Got to give that guy at least 400, not 1,000, 400. Quite easy just to speed along here and make the same mistakes over and over again. So next one, 400, Dynamesh res. I think we've got one more at the back here. No, we've got them all, cool. Let's just scroll through all those really quickly. Yeah, there we go. All Dynamesh 400. So as before, we started to bring some character into this this arm and variation. So I'm going to start once again with the inflation tool. There we go. Start to fill in some of those gaps. Choose the next one. Flate that up a little bit. That's interesting. All right, let's just up that a little bit. Now, you know, just as before, this will take a little bit of time, but I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm just going to skip ahead from merging all of this stuff into that flow that we like, and I'm just going to talk about the ends of the fingers a little bit. So I'm going to get the snake hookout tool this time, and that's this guy over here. And I want to start to give Groot some fingers. So I'm just going to bring down the size of the brush a little bit, up a little bit more. I just want to stroke this guy out here like that. That's pretty cool. That's a nice start, actually. I'm just going to pull at it a little bit. All right. And, you know, you can see that the geometry is getting a little stressed. So time for another Dynamesh update. Control, left mouse, shift, bring out the marquee. There we go. Let's have a little look at what we've got here, this digit. All right. Now, you know, spend a bit of time on each one of these fingers. All right. Make them look a little finger-like. Let's inflate just the end of it. There we go. That's okay. All right. Next guy. Bring out a finger. Up we go. Re-Dynamesh. Next guy. Bring up another finger. Re-Dynamesh. This guy over here. All right. So we're further along, and I'm quite happy with my arm. Now, along the process, I actually got rid of one of the elements. We have five of them, and I brought it down to four because I want to do something a little special for the thumb here. So really, we only needed four fingers. But before we talk about the thumb, I'm now going to delete the other arm. So let's just select it in the subtool there, press delete. And I'm going to duplicate the one that we're happy with. And then I'm just going to come down to the deformation tab, and we're going to mirror it and send it to the other side. So there we go. That's pretty cool. So then I'm going to bring a little variation to it just by rotating it on the transpose tool. So I'm just going to bring it up a little bit. There we go. That's pretty cool. And that just gives us a slight pose. All right. Cool. So the next thing I'm going to do is the thumbs. And I'm going to do something a little different here. I want to create leaves for the thumbs, and I could, I guess, append a sphere and kind of sculpt a leaf, but a leaf can be quite a technical piece of geometry. So I'm actually going to jump back into one of the traditional 3D packages, and I'm going to import in a leaf. So let's head over to that now. All right, so I'm going to create the leaf in Max to start off with. So the first thing I'm going to do is over on the Primitives tab, I'm going to lay a plane into the scene. Let's just place that here. And I'm going to give it, as it already has, a length of 8 and a width of 2. And of course the crease down the middle will be where the leaf will actually bend. So from this plane, I'm going to create a leaf shape, and I'm just going to drop a modifier, and I'm going to use the FFD 3x3. Okay, it's going to open up its control points. Select the top row here. I'm just going to scale them in. You get a nice smooth bend there. And I'm going to do the same for the back row as well. Let's pull that in. There we go. Looking a little thin, so I'm just going to scale out the center there. All right, that's a pretty good leaf shape. All right, so I'm just going to collapse this. So now I'd like to put a stem in the middle. So I'm just going to create create the cylinder. So let's just throw that there. I'm just going to turn on the snap tool here, okay? And that will allow me to rotate it in little iterations. It's a little bit easier to reach 90 degrees, okay? So bring that nice and flat like that. And I'm just going to scale it up. Bring it down some. There we go. Let's just scale up a bit more so it reaches the top there. Okay. Now I'm just going to click on the Modify tab, and I'm going to also give this cylinder a length of 8 segments in height, so and then it matches the leaf. Okay. I'm going to put a FFD onto the stem as well, but I'm going to choose the 2x2 version this time. Open up the points. Select the top and just scale that down so that it tapers at the top. And I'm going to right click and collapse that as well. Alright, so the leaf is presently wafer thin, so I'd like to add some thickness to it. So, well, what I'm going to do is first I'm going to show you the way that I wouldn't recommend doing it. So, let me just turn this into an editable poly. Now, if anyone knows a better way of doing this, you would think that selecting all of the faces and using extrude and bringing it up would do that. At least this would be the Maya way of doing it, but if you look underneath, you realize that there isn't actually an under section here, so that doesn't work very well for us. I'm just going to undo that. The better Max way would appear to be adding a shell. So let me just find the shell modifier. And there you go. You have the ability to choose the thickness this way. So I'm going to bring that down a little bit. All right. I'm fairly happy with that. I'm just going to collapse that again. I'm just going to raise this stem that's got a little bit lost in the center of the leaf there. Let's pull that back a bit. All right. So next I'd like to add a bend into this leaf. So I'm going to reapply a FFD on it. Once again, the 3x3. So open up the control points and select the ones on either side. Okay, let's just lift up. Okay, that's not bad. However, it's floating away a little bit, so let's just bring it down a tad. Alright, not bad. Just a little bit more. Perfect. Alright, let's collapse that. Now, I'm going to attach these two items together. And the way I can do that is if I just bring out my control over here, and you find the attach button. So let me just attach that to there. That's good. Attach. There we go. I'm just going to put another FFD. Let's try the 4x4 this time. Okay, open up the control points, select the middle two rows, and I'm going to push that up. And we have a leaf. Alright, so that's our leaf, and next I'll show you how to do this in Maya. Okay, so we're back in Maya again, and I'm going to begin to create this leaf. The way I'm going to do that is I'm going to start by creating this plane. I'm just going to zoom in and go over to its history, and I think I'm going to give it maybe a height of about 8, I think, would be enough. And we're going to give it a width of just 2. Okay. So this middle crease down here will represent the center of the leaf. I'm just gonna scale it inwards a little bit. That's a pretty good start. Okay, so I'd like to generate a leaf shape out of this plane. And one of the ways I'm gonna do that is I'm gonna use the lattice deformer. And that can be found up here in the animation tab under create deformers and lattice. So it's been applied to the plane. It's not very clear because it is only a plane after all. But if you look over here, we have a few values. So I'm just going to turn this value to 3 and perhaps this one to 4. Okay, that's pretty good. I'm just going to change the FFD to 10. There we go. Now what this does is it makes the lattice bend in a very smooth way. So the higher the value on that, the smoother the fall off. You'll see how that's going to look in a moment. So I'm just going to right click, I want to select the lattice points. Now they're indicated in these purple dots. So I'm going to select the top row here. I'm just going to bring them in and you get that nice smooth bend. Okay, and that smooth bend was caused by our values in the FFD here. So I'm going to choose the last ones as well. Bend that in. And there we go, quite quickly we've got a pretty good leaf shape there. All right, so I'm just going to remove this lattice. I'm going to go to Edit, and I'm going to go to Delete by Type and History. Okay, so I want a little bit of thickness in this leaf, so I'm just going to select the faces, select them all. You can press the Up to move the faces in a moment, but I'm going to extrude using this extrude button. Okay, lift them up. There we go, we've got a little bit of thickness to our leaf, that's enough. Right click, go back to object mode. Alright, so now I would like to add a stem to this leaf. I'm going to do that with a cylinder. Whoa, that's arrived nice and big, so let's just scale that guy down. Alright, I'm just going to rotate him on his side, there we go, about minus 90 by the looks of it. Okay, just going to scale him down a bit more, stretch him out. Much like the leaf, over in the inputs, I'm going to give him a height of 8. Okay, so you can see actually he's in alignment with that. That's not bad. Okay, so I'd like to make this stem go thinner as it reaches the top. I want it to taper off. So similarly again, I'm going to use a lattice on it. So let's just add that there. I'm going to bring these numbers down actually to about 1. Okay. I'm going to right click, get the lattice points out, select that top row, and just begin to scale it in a little bit. I'm just going to lift it up as well because it's getting lost in the center of it. That's pretty good, that's okay. It's going to go to Edit, Delete by Type, History to remove it again. So now the next thing I'd like to do is I'd like to put a bend in this leaf. So I'm going to put another lattice on. Where's it gone? Create lattice. Okay. I'm going to give it 3. Okay. I'm just going to right click, get lattice points up. I got those points in the middle. Yeah. I'm just going to select the ones on the side. I'm going to bring those up. Okay. Now, that's before I've actually put any values on the FFD. So let's see what happens if I do it in the middle of the operation. You should see a smoother fall off appear as I put them in. All right, so tell you what, let's bring that down, put it back, there we go. All right, not bad, not bad. Maybe I'll bring those down. No, that's pretty good. All right, let's delete by type, history. Now I'm going to combine these all together. Okay, over at polygons, combine. And we're going to go for that last bend that I'm after, back to animation, back to the lattice. I'm going to give it 4. All right. FFD of 10. Right click, lattice points. I'm going to select the middle two. I'm just going to push this up like that. And there we have it. We've got a leaf. All right. Once again, edit, delete by type, history. All right. So I think it'll be good enough to go on to Groot. Tell you what, though. I just want to shrink this last one. Just one more time so it goes to a tip. Yeah. All right, that's pretty good. Okay, so we're back over in ZBrush, and I'm now going to import the leaf that we created earlier. So the way to import an object is to first append any object you like a sphere, into the subtool palette. Don't forget to select it because your last tool is still selected, so select the sphere. And then I'm just going to go to import, and then I'm going to bring the leaf in, and it should go on top of it. So there we go, that's overridden the sphere we had there. So our item is probably pretty tiny, I can't actually see it anywhere, so I'm just going to select the transpose move tool. I'm just going to draw it out in the middle of the scene here, because it might probably be sitting in the middle of Groot's body, but I can't see it, so let's just move it out. Oh, there he is, he's very small, but here he is over here. Okay, so let's just zoom into him a little bit by pressing frame. Alright, let's go zoom out a little bit more. Okay, so we want to rotate him onto Groot's bum. So I'm just going to drag him out, press rotate. Let's just see if we can come to a rotation that we're happy with. Let's just try this. Rotate him up. Actually, I would say that's probably the bottom is upside down, isn't it? So let's just do this, and then maybe spin it in the center. Let's just bring this up again. There we go. And I'm just going to move him over here. So rotate the camera around, see if we can get that to touch the thumb spike that I've got there. Let's just bring it there a bit. Oh, we're almost in place. Move him across. Oh, that's not too bad. I'm just going to rotate it again, so draw that out. I'm just going to rotate him around a little bit. All right. Let's just move him up a tiny bit more. Not bad. Let's rotate again. Maybe. I think that would do just fine, actually. Is it touching? Let's just give it a little shimmy across. Perfect. Okay. I like where that is. So I'm just going to turn on polyframe, take a look at the components. And of course it was made of the stem and the leaf. There's a couple of things I want to do. It's a very fragile and thin looking item. So I'm just going to go to polygroups. I'm going to go to auto groups to separate these two items. I'm going to open the subtool palette and I'm going to split them both momentarily. So let's just do a group split. So as you can see, we've got the stem and the leaf here. And I want to inflate and dynamesh the two of these items just to give them that extra bit of thickness. So I'm going to go down to the deformations tab and I'm going to begin to inflate. I think the leaf is selected right now. So let's just bring that up a little bit. About that will do. Okay. Just going to go down to geometry and I'm going to dynamesh this object at about 256. Let's see how that looks. Bit low resolution actually, so let's just press Ctrl Z to undo. I'm going to whop it up to maybe 600. Let's try that. One more time. I'll give it 1K. Why not? Okay. Okay, I'm quite happy about that. And I'm going to give it a little smooth with one little relax iteration. Not bad. Cool. Open the subtool palette. Select the stem. I'm going to do the exact same thing. Come down to the deformation tab. And I'm going to inflate it. Okay, let's just bring that up quite thick. Okay, that's pretty good. And I'm going to go to geometry, give it also 1K resolution dynamesh. Okay, I'm going to select the standard brush and I'm just going to smooth the tip so that it tapers off a little bit more. There we go, yeah. Alright, I'm going to merge those two items together. Merge down. Okay. Turn off the polyframe so we can see what that looks like. That's not too bad. And I'm just going to dynamesh them together now, okay? Also at the same resolution, dynamesh 1K. Alright. So now we've got a group thumb. So what we've got to do is repeat that process onto the other hand and maybe give it some variation. And we've got Groot's hands completed. Excellent. So we're back in Max, and I'm going to first create the potting spike in here. So in this viewport, I'm just going to press Alt W to maximize it. And inside the Primitives tab, I'm going to grow a cylinder in the center of my scene. So let's just pull that out and scale it up. Just going to bring down the height segments to 1, just keep this nice and simple. I'm going to make it really, really smooth. Okay, so that's pretty good. On the Modifier tab, I'm going to turn this into an editable poly, and I'm going to select the verts on this button here. I'm going to select the bottom row and zoom in a little with Z. I'm just going to scale those in to about there. That's pretty good, actually. Just going to open that up a little bit. And that's the first part. And I'm going to do the exact same thing again, create another cylinder. Screw that here, raise it up. And I'm just going to move that into the center of the potting spike. Let's just lift this up. I'm just going to scale it up a little bit. And that is that. That's our potting spike. Okay, so I'm going to show you this in Maya next, and then we're going to bring it into ZBrush and dynamesh it down. Okay, so we're back in Maya again, and I'm going to create the potting spike. And this should be a relatively easy thing to do. So I'm going to create a cylinder. So I'm going to raise him up a little bit. I'm going to give him a lot of subdivisions, so it's a nice, smooth cylinder. Yeah, that's plenty. I'm just going to hold right mouse click button and get the vertex. Just going to select the bottom row there, and then I'm going to bring that in nice and tight. Not to a complete point. Yeah, that should do. Just going to select the top row. Raise it up a little bit. Okay, back to object mode. That's a good start. Create another cylinder. I'm going to raise that one up as well. Just going to scale it in. I'm going to smooth him up as well. Pretty cool. That's what I like. Raise it up. I'm just going to press 5 to go back into shaded mode. So I'm just going to shrink that a little bit. Scale it a bit more. All right. Okay. Now that's perfect. That's really all there is to it. Okay, so we're back in ZBrush, and I'm going to import the potting spike. So first thing I need to do is just append a sphere or any other shape. And don't forget to select it in the subtool palette, because it always has the last tool that you had selected. So with that selected, I'm just going to import it from my desktop. Let's go over there and bring in the potting spike. Okay, so it's right in the scene, but it appears to be in the middle of Groot's body just over here. So just going to get the transpose tool. I'm just going to draw out this tool and drag it down. And you can see that it's a little bit small, so I'm just going to go to scale, draw out the transpose tool again, and just scale it up. That looks pretty good. All right, I'm just going to move it down a bit. Let's just turn to the side and let's see where this is. Okay, so it's still out of place. Let's just bring it across. And I'd say that's looking pretty good. All right, let's just move this up so I can see it clearly. Okay, so the next thing I'd like to do is to dynamesh our potting spike. So I'm just going to zoom into it. Let's frame it here and isolate it. And if you just turn on the poly frame, you might remember that it's made from two cylinders of just intersecting geometry. So we're just going to open up the geometry tab. And we'll dynamesh it at about a resolution of 512. So let's just type that in and press the dynamesh button. Give it a few seconds. And we have a beautifully fused operation there. It's going to open the deformation tab and relax it a little bit so it's nice and smooth. And there we have our dynameshed potting spike. So with that done, the next thing I'd like to do is to subtract the potting spike from the base mesh here. So let's just turn on the transparency mode, and you can see how this should appear. So we want to cut out this this peg area here from the base, leaving a cavity for it to slot in. Now, the way to go about doing that is, first of all, I need to duplicate the original. And the reason being, when we do the operation, the subtracted one will disappear. So I'm just going to duplicate that. And I'm going to isolate it briefly. Now, something that I would like to do is I want to inflate this duplicate just a little bit. The reason being, I'd like the cavity to just be a couple of microns larger than the actual original. And this way, when they are printed, it will slot in nice and smoothly. So to do that, open up the deformation tab, and we're just going to inflate it by about 3. And you'll see that expand. That's cool. I'm just going to refresh the dynamesh on it. Geometry. Let's give it another one there. Okay, that's pretty cool. I'm just going to turn on the original. I'm going to have a little look under, let's turn off the poly frame and just look at the transparency mode. And you'll see that the original is sitting just inside the expanded one. Okay, so let's just turn off there so you can see it popping on and off. There it is underneath it. Okay, so back to this one again. Okay, let's just zoom out. I'm just going to turn on the base, and here it is again. So what I'm going to do is turn on the polyframe one more time, and this is important because I'm going to go to the polygroups tab, and we're going to select group as a dynamesh subtraction button. And when you press that button, you'll notice that the polyframe turns white. There we go, that's a good indication that it's actually worked. And if we just go to the subtool palette, there's one last thing that we need to do, and that is we need to turn on the subtraction icon on the tool. Okay, so now we've done that, I'm just going to move this up the palette, and I'm going to merge it with the base. So let's just merge down, say OK. And now I'm going to do another dynamesh on it, and it should subtract successfully. So let's press that now. Okay, so the potting spike has disappeared, which means that the operation is complete. So if I just turn off the polyframe here, and let's just take a look underneath. Perfect, we've got a subtraction that's worked perfectly. So what I'm gonna do is, I'm just gonna put it back down, I'm just gonna turn on the original potting spike, and we're just gonna turn on the transparency mode, and you'll see that would now fit in there perfectly once it's 3D printed. So that's just perfect. Let's just turn off transparency mode again. I'm just gonna turn on all the subtools. It's just frame us in, and we're nearly done. Next up, we'll be modeling the head. Okay, so in this part of the tutorial, we're going to begin to look at sculpting Groot's head and getting that overall character likeness. We're going to begin by using that sphere that's been sitting on top of the base mesh from the beginning of the tutorial. So I'm just going to get busy sculpting, and I'm going to leave the video running at about twice the speed. But the three main areas that I want to pay attention to are, one, getting in the main forms and that overall likeness of Groot, paying a little bit of attention to how I take care of the eyes and the eyelids, and then finally finishing up with the complicated mass of branches sitting on top of Groot's head. So I'm going to dive in right now. Okay, so we're at the eyes now, and you can see that a little earlier I've created two eyeballs, and that's quite easily done. I just append to the subtool palette a sphere, and using the transpose tool, I move it into one of Groot's eye sockets. And then also on the subtool palette, there's the duplicate button, and this will create another eyeball. And rather than move it to the other eye socket, just scroll down to the deformation tab, and click on mirror in X, I think, and that will instantly switch it over to the other side of Groot's face, and now you've got two eyeballs. Okay, so now you've done that, go to the subtool palette again and merge both of the eyeballs together, and then we're going to dynamesh it to quite a high resolution, about 1K. And the next thing we do is, with the standard brush selected, what we have to do is holding control and left click and draw a mask over the top half of the eyeballs. so that you've just got the top hemisphere masked over. And inside the subtool palette at the bottom, there's an extract button and a thickness value. Now, depending on the scale of your scene, you just need a low value, normally about 0.01 or 0.02. You press the extract button. What that does is it gives you a preview of the eyelid that you're going to lift off of the eyeball. So if you're happy with the thickness, you just press accept. And if you look up in the subtool palette, you'll notice that it has now created the eyelids. But if you look closely on those little thumbnails, you can see that there's still masking data on both of the subtools. So once again, just holding control and left drag out the marquee to unselect the mask on both of those subtools. Okay, nice. So just repeat that process now for the bottom half of the eyeballs. So control, left click out the marquee, mask the bottom half, press extract and accept if you're happy, and then swipe off the masks by holding control and dragging out the marquee again. And that's it. So now you've got your two eyelids, you can, using the move tool, begin to open them and start to create those a lot of expression on the face and wide-eyed group cuteness. And that's a nice easy way to do the eyelids. Hope it's working out. So I'm going to make a start on the branches on top of Groot's head, and the first thing I'm going to do is create a new sphere by appending it in the subtool palette again. I'm just going to get the transpose tool and move that sphere on top of his head, and I'm going to up the dynamesh resolution on that sphere to about 256 should be enough, 512 if you really must, and I'm going to use the snake hook brush and I'm just going to stroke that sphere and start to pull out a tentacle, which is what the snake hook brush is really good for doing. I'm just going to keep refreshing that dynamesh, just start bringing out that tentacle or branch until we've got a nice long wave. And at this point now, it's really more of a repeating process. It's not that complicated. All you have to keep on doing is duplicating those branches, move them aside, and then add a little difference to them using the move tool or continuing with the snake hook tool, and just get a bit of a variation in them. And then just keep filling up that volume on top of his head. So quite quickly, your subtool palette will begin to fill up with a lot of these branches. So once you've got a considerable bunch, just merge them all down into one big clump, and then you can continue to duplicate that, and you can mirror that in the deformation tab, and start to add a little variation into that one too. And you'll get a feel for what's the right number of branches to place on top of his head based on the reference in the corner there. So now we've got enough branches on top of Groot's head, we need to do a bit of a cleanup. They're probably all intersecting with one another. So open up the subtool palette, merge all of those branches together, and then run down the tools tab and open up polygroups and do an auto group on all of those branches. And of course, they'll all be assigned their unique identification color. So now you've done that, once again, go back to the subtool palette and split all the polygroups. So now all of those branches will be separated again. Split up now, you'll notice the subtool palette is once again filled with loads of branches, but there's nothing to worry about. It's not as daunting as it looks. Just using Alt and left clicking on each of those branches in the viewport, you can quite quickly scroll through each one of those, and using the move tool again, just start to de-intersect each of those branches, giving them their own space so they don't all feel like they're one on top of each other. It's going to start to feel more like his hair. So we're nearly finished. Next, we're going to merge down all of the subtools into a single tool. So inside the subtool tab, just begin to merge down all of the objects. And once that's done, we're going to run a pretty high resolution Dynamesh operation on it, maybe 1K or 2K. Okay, so now that operation's done, we're just going to generally smooth over all of those fusion points where all the branches reach Groot's head and just kind of turn into a more continuously smooth surface. So with everything dynameshed down, essentially Groot is finished. If you like, you can begin to color over him. You might well be getting a color 3D print. Mine was actually printed in PLA plastic, just one color. It was pale gold. It kind of gave off a nice kind of brownish bark color. So, but just for the sakes of finishing them off, I'm going to do a little bit of coloring on this. So I'm just going to use the standard brush, and I'm going to go to RGB and turn off the add and subtractive function of the brush, and just start to find a nice kind of barkish color. And I'm just going to fill the entire tool with that color. And next I'm going to just get a bit of green. Slowly, I'm just going to bring down the RGB intensity and just start to just go over his the tips of his fingers and of course the top of his hair. So a couple of other details that you can pick up on are all of the cavities. So if you just go down to the masking tab, open it up, inside you can select by cavity, and that'll get all those cracks. So once they're selected, you can just start to fill that in with a darker color, maybe black at a very low intensity. And then we'll finish off just by coloring in his eyes, which I believe are a very, very dark shade of brown and, of course, a black pupil. So that's it, really. We're finished. So we're inside of Cura, and Cura is a software that belongs to the creators of the 3D printer, the Ultimaker. And you can download this program right now as well as you like, and you can have a little tinker around and get an understanding for how to get your geometry print ready. So I'm just going to give a very brief overview of how this program works. So starting with this checkered table that you see in front of us, this is supposed to represent the real size build plate of the Ultimaker printer. So the first thing I'm going to do is bring in my geometry, both Groot and his potting spike. So they've both arrived in the middle of the table, extremely tiny. And up here you can see that Cura was doing some thinking, and it's concluded that it would take just 3 minutes and a very, very tiny amount of filament to print them. Well, it would, they are pretty small. So we'd like to scale these two items up, and I'm just going to click on it. It will zoom in automatically, and I'm suddenly presented with a few more tools, like a scale. So I'm just going to click on scale. I'm just going to roll the middle mouse button and zoom out a bit. I'm going to pull on this anchor and start to scale Groot up to about this size. And notice that it not only does it start to recalculate how long it's going to take to print again, but it also quite cleverly nudged the tiny little potting spike out of its way. It's clever enough to know that it doesn't like to have two volumes intersecting with each other. So I'm just going to select the potting spike as well, scroll out a bit. Let's scale him up as well to about, yeah, that looks about right. And because of that nudge that it does, it's done it again, and on this occasion it's pushed it outside of the build area, and it's highlighted now in grey. So I'm just going to left mouse click on it, and I'm just going to drag him back in until he is highlighted in yellow again. And it's going to automatically rethink. I didn't like that. Let's keep on pushing it around until we find a happy place. There we go, it seems to be happy now, and it's going to continue to calculate once again. So I'm just going to let it think for a while. So it's happy where it is now. I just want to talk about these options up here. So if I just drop this down, you'll see that we're presented with a few viewing modes. And all that calculating that it does is a little bit more than just there to tell us how long it's going to take to print. And it's doing a procedure called slicing, where it's actually thinking about every single layer that the 3D printer is going to lay down. So let's click on layers and have a little look at what's going on. And as you can see, Groot starts to emanate in a kind of viewable and layered view. What's more, it will also show you, and here they come, the supports. So if you're familiar at all with extrusion techniques in printing, they tend to come with 3D supports, unlike STL prints. So it's also calculating what that would look like. and you can get a good idea about what would be the best orientation to print your geometry. So let's let it finish its calculations, and then we'll see if we can find another orientation that might produce less supports, because the more supports you have, the more material that you're using. So you're always trying to find that happy medium of time and material use. So we'll let it think itself over for a little while. Okay, so I'm just gonna go back into normal mode. I'm just gonna zoom out a little bit, rotate. And I'm going to begin to reorientate him by clicking on this rotate button. So I'm just gonna pull this axis circle here and begin to rotate him around. And we've done it now 90 degrees. It's also gonna automatically pop him back up onto the plate. Let's change the orientation of this as well. I'm just gonna lay it down a little flatter. I'm gonna try to get as much of his surface to actually touch the plate. So I'm gonna try something like that, for example. Oh, one more, let's give it one more angle. All right, okay, that would do. And it's gonna think itself over again. I'm just gonna go to layers and you'll see it slicing away. Okay, so it's done its calculations again. And I would say on this occasion, the amount of supports that have been produced is probably a little bit less than when we had it at the previous orientation, laying flat on the floor. And the same goes for the potting spike as well. So just one more tool I'd like to show you. On the right here, we have this layer bar. And if you just scroll down, it actually allows you to go through every single generated layer. You can really go in there and see what's going on in the print. And it's very, very useful if you're having any problems. And that concludes our very brief lesson on Cura. So that's the end of this video tutorial. I really hope it helped somebody out there or might have taught somebody something. This was actually my first featured narrated video tutorial I've ever made. It was quite a challenge. I hope it was clear enough for everybody. I look forward to making more videos in the future. So until that time, please share or like this video if you know anybody that would like to watch it. Thanks again. Until next time. Thank you.